What are the DNA differences and similarities between England and Wales, and how different are they? Now, in ancient times, the land we call Wales today was inhabited by tribes of Celtic Britons, such as the Silures. Ancient England was home to similar tribes who belonged to the same broad people as well. This dramatically changed, of course, after the Anglo-Saxons arrived, following the Roman withdrawal in the 5th century AD. The Normans then invaded both regions in the 11th century, and by 1283, Wales was essentially under English control, after King Edward I conquered the independent Welsh principalities. In the mid-16th century, Wales was formally annexed into the Kingdom of England, integrating its legal system and governance. Despite this, Wales retained a distinct cultural and linguistic identity up until now, and Welsh is one of the six Celtic languages still spoken today. Yet what are the DNA differences between England and Wales? Well, both peoples descend from three ancient sources: post-Ice Age hunter-gatherers, then early European farmers, and then steppe ancestry, with this largely brought into England and Wales, ancient England and Wales, through the Bellbeaker culture. England and Wales also both saw a large-scale migration between around 1000 and 875 BC. This was what a 2021 study published in Nature found, and this increased early European farmer ancestry in both countries, with this migration only affecting southern Britain and not Scotland, which is quite interesting. So the ancient genetic history of both England and Wales is very similar up until this point, and during the Iron Age this similarity continued, as the Romans had a very limited genetic impact on all of Britain in general. It was during the medieval period into the medieval period though that we start to see real differences between English and Welsh DNA. This was due to later invasions and migrations that had a much greater impact on England than Wales, including the Vikings that we'll discuss in a second. This means that Wales retains much more ancient British DNA than its neighbour, and this is a defining feature of Welsh DNA in general. As the 2015 Fine-Scale Genetic Map of Britain found, as well as other studies, the Welsh appear more similar to the earliest settlers of Britain following the last Ice Age than any other people in the UK. Now, a key driver of this is geography. Wales has benefited from the fact that it's tucked away to the west of England, protecting its eastern side to a large degree, and Ireland also protects its west to some degree as well. It also seems that at times when there was foreign migrations into eastern Britain, ancient Britons often fled west for safety, into Wales. If we look at the Vikings, for example, they had a notable impact on the DNA of England, Ireland and Scotland, yet this was very limited in Wales. Although Viking raids did occur in Welsh coastal areas, there was little to no large-scale Norse settlement. As you can see in this table, Wales has the lowest genetic impact from the Vikings compared to other places in this region. So one difference between English and Welsh DNA is the lack of Viking admixture in Wales, and the lack of Scandinavian DNA in general. Now, another difference between English and Welsh DNA is the Anglo-Saxons, of course, and England obviously gets its name from the Anglo-Saxons, meaning the land of the Angles. This brought much more continental-derived genes into England and Wales. In general, when it comes to southern Britain, a genetic gradient runs east to west. East Anglia is genetically closer to the Dutch and the Germans, while the west of England and Wales often cluster with Celtic populations, broadly speaking anyway. And we see this clear genetic transformation in ancient English DNA when the Anglo-Saxons arrived. A really interesting paper was published in 2022 in Nature that looked at the formation of the early English gene pool. The authors found that before the Middle Ages, post-Neolithic individuals from Britain and Ireland carried overwhelmingly the Y chromosomal haplogroup R1b P312, especially the subhaplogroup RL21. By contrast, the early medieval population of England exhibits a substantial fraction of continental-derived haplotypes belonging to haplogroups R1BU106, R1AM420, I2A1L460 and I1M253, which are commonly found in Northern and Central Europe. The impact of the Vikings on England also further increased some of these markers, such as I1 and especially R1BU106, as well as some branches of R1A, such as R1AL664 and R1AZ284. The impact of the Vikings on England, though, was from Danish Vikings, who had much higher levels of R1BU106 compared to Norwegian or Swedish Vikings. And I did just make a member-only video on Viking DNA differences that I'll link below that goes into more detail. And if you're enjoying this video, please consider subscribing. So we've seen that obviously the Vikings and the Anglo-Saxons had much more impact on England and Wales and brought much more continental European haplogroups and genes in general into England and Wales, with Wales much more sheltered from these episodes from a genetic perspective. And we will look at how this shaped modern English and Welsh haplogroups later in the video. Now, as well as some differences between the two countries, there is also internal divisions in both nations. Wales has a north-south divide, for instance. The reasons for this are numerous, but include geography, ancient kingdoms, language and historical patterns. There are also some interesting yet more subtle differences in Wales. One is along the Lanskr line in southwest Wales. This marks a historical boundary between Welsh-speaking communities in the north and English-speaking settlers in the south, mainly of Norman and Flemish descent. This region is sometimes known as Little England beyond Wales. A genetic study by UCL found that this cultural divide also left a subtle but detectable genetic trace, meaning that this boundary has persisted for nearly 1,000 years. England also has internal divisions, namely north versus south and east versus west. The highest levels of Anglo-Saxon ancestry in England are found in the east and southeast, for instance, notably in East Anglia at around 40% in many cases. Western areas, on the other hand, have more ancient British DNA to a large degree, with some overlap with Welsh genetic clusters, for example. So how has all this affected the modern DNA of English and Welsh people? Well, if you look at this table of Y-DNA haplogroups, you can see that Welsh men mainly belong to branches of R1B-L21, at around 70-80%. This is known as a Celtic lineage today, as it's very high amongst peoples who also speak other Celtic languages, notably in Ireland and Scotland. Yet this branch of R1B-L21 was brought into Britain and Ireland through the Bellbeaker culture, and it shows how the Y-DNA marker of Welsh men hasn't been overly affected by later migrations. England, on the other hand, has much higher levels of the Germanic-connected haplogroup R1B-U106. This reflects largely the Anglo-Saxon influence, as well as some Viking admixture, with Danish Vikings in particular having high levels of R1B-U106, given their proximity to Germany. We also see the impact of the Vikings and to some extent the Anglo-Saxons when we look at the levels of I1 as well, which is between 10 and 15% in England, compared to 1 to 4% in Wales. This was a key marker of the Vikings. Now, England still has decent levels of R1B-L21, reflecting the influence of the Bellbeakers and then the Celtic Britons, but the Anglo-Saxons and the Vikings made a notable impact on English DNA, a pattern that is much less pronounced in Wales. There are also some interesting quirks as well. Haplogroup E1B1B, typically rare in Britain, appears at unusually high levels, reportedly up to 33%, in the North Welsh town of Abergele, according to data from local and surname-based genetic projects, though not peer-reviewed studies. This lineage is linked to Neolithic farmers, Roman soldiers or settlers, as well as later Mediterranean trade routes, and it is most common in North Africa and Southern Europe today. Its presence in such high concentration may reflect a founder effect or localised paternal expansion in Wales. Or it may be a corruption in the data, a simple error in the data, and perhaps should be treated cautiously. But I thought it was interesting to note, and please let me know your thoughts below on this. Now, this is not to say that there hasn't been population movements between the two countries, and some overlap as well, but Wales overall has remained far more genetically isolated than England. Now, on the maternal side, the mitochondrial haplogroups in both countries are more similar, yet we do see subtle differences, as this table shows. Wales has slightly higher levels of U5, for example, than England. This is a very old haplogroup in Europe that was the most common maternal marker in Western hunter-gatherers, the first people to walk these lands after the ice melted. This again reflects the overall pattern that Wales shares more genetic affinity with some of the earliest peoples who moved into this region after the ice melted, where many people in England have more affinity with the likes of the Dutch or the Germans. So overall, while both are closely related in general, the English and the Welsh have been shaped by different demographic histories, one of relative isolation in Wales and one of successful migrations and admixture in England. But what are the differences between Scottish and English DNA? Well, to find out, please click here. Thanks for watching, please subscribe and hit the bell, and let me know your thoughts below and what your ancestry is, if you've got English or Welsh ancestry, or if you're from these countries. But yeah, thanks again for watching, and I'll see you next time.